me and spare thyself. Lay not upon me a burden greater than I can bear. But the prophet, peace be upon him, answered him, saying, I swear by God, if they put the sun in my right hand, and the moon in my left, on condition that I abandon this cause before he hath made it victorious, or I have perished therein, I would not abandon it. Then, with tears in his eyes, he rose to his feet and turned to go. But his uncle called him back. Son of my brother, he said, go thou and say what thou wilt, for by God I will never forsake thee on any account.
When they found that their words had achieved nothing with Abu Talib, the Quraysh still hesitated to attack his nephew directly. For as a chief of clan, Abu Talib had power to grant inviolate protection, and it was in the interests of every other chief of clan in Mecca to see that the rights of chieftaincy were duly respected. So they confined themselves for the moment to organizing a widespread persecution of all those adherents of the new religion who had no one to protect them.
They consulted together in an attempt to form a common policy about the cause of their trouble. The situation was exceedingly grave. The time of the pilgrimage would soon be upon them, and Arabs would come to Mecca from all over Arabia. They, the Quraysh, had a high reputation for hospitality, not only as regards food and drink, but also because they made every man welcome, both him and his gods. But this year pilgrims would hear their gods insulted by Muhammad, peace be upon him, and his followers, and they would be urged to forsake the religion of their forefathers, and to adopt a new religion, which appeared to have numerous disadvantages.
No doubt many of them would not come to Mecca again, which would not only be bad for trade, but would also diminish the honor in which the guardians of the sanctuary were now held. At the worst, the Arabs might league together to drive them out of Mecca and to establish another tribe or group of tribes in their place, as they themselves had previously done with Khuzar, and as the Khuzar had done with Jurhum. It was therefore imperative that the visiting Arabs should be told that Muhammad in no way represented the Quraysh. But although it was easy to deny his prophethood, that was merely an expression of an opinion, and indirectly was inviting others to listen to his claims and judge for themselves.
Something else needed to be said in addition, and here lay their weakness. For some had taken to saying that he was a soothsayer, others that he was possessed, others that he was a poet, and yet others that he was a sorcerer. They consulted Walid, the son of Mughira, probably the most influential man of the tribe at that time, as to which of these accusations would be best likely to convince, and he rejected them all as wide of the mark. But on second thought, he decided that although the man in question was certainly not a sorcerer, he had at least one thing in common with sorcerers. He had the power to separate a man from his father, or from his brother, or from his wife, or from his family in general.
He advised them, therefore, to let their unanimous accusation be along those lines, namely that Muhammad, peace be upon him, was a dangerous sorcerer, to be avoided at all costs. Having readily agreed to follow his advice, they decided that outside the town, all the roads by which Mecca was approached must be manned, and that visitors must be warned in advance to be on their guard against Muhammad, peace be upon him, for they knew from their own experience how winning he could be. Had he not been, before he began preaching, one of the best-loved men in Mecca? nor had his tongue lost any of its eloquence, nor his presence anything of its compelling majesty.
They carried out their plans with zeal and thoroughness. In at least one particular case, however, they were doomed to failure from the outset. A man of the Bani Rifa'a named Abu Dar, his tribe lived to the northwest of Mecca, not far from the Red Sea. He had already heard of the Prophet, peace be upon him, and of the opposition to him. Like most of his tribesmen, Abu Dar was a highwayman. But unlike them, he was a firm believer in the oneness of God, and he refused to pay any respect to idols.
His brother, Unais, went to Mecca for some reason, and on his return, he told Abu Dar that there was a man of the Quraysh who claimed to be a prophet, and who said, "There is no God but God," and his people had disowned him in consequence.
This daily program, Biography of the Holy Prophet, was written and prepared by Makram Maluhi.
And read by
Sheila Ayash
and Sean Toner.
This was a Radio Kuwait production.
That the power overload and the short circuits is the leading cause of fire in Kuwait. Remember to switch off all the power outlets after the use. This message was brought to you by the Public Relations and the Media Department from the Kuwait Fire Service Directorate.
Thank you. weapons of fire.
Kill him with kindness. Kill him with kindness. Kill him. Kill him. Kill him with kindness. Kill him with kindness. Kill him with kindness. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead now.
chocolate, salted candy, and it seems so. How my baby let it rain. I'm addicted to your sugar, dripping straight into my vein. You're something cheating, you're something new. You got me always, and I tell ya, I can't hold on.
This is Radio Kuwait. The time now is 9:30 p.m. Kuwait time. Hello, welcome to the 9:30 news update. I'm Hamid Ibrahim. His Honor Emir Sheikh Sabah Ahmed Al-Jaber al-Sabah received this morning at Bayan Palace the National Assembly Speaker Mirzouk Ali Al-Ghanem. His Honor the Emir then received His Honor Sheikh Jaber al-Mubarak al-Hamed al-Sabah, the Prime Minister. His Honor the Emir also received the First Deputy Premier and Foreign Minister Sheikh Sabah al-Khalid al-Hamed al-Sabah. His Honor the Emir Sheikh Sabah Ahmed Al-Jaber al-Sabah received this morning at Bayan Palace the First Deputy Premier and Foreign Minister Sheikh Sabah al-Khalid al-Hamed al-Sabah, along with a special envoy of His Excellency the Kenyan President and Secretary General of the Jubilee Party, Raphael Tuju. The Kenyan envoy delivered a written message to His Honor the Emir from His Excellency President Uhuru Kenyatta that dealt with bilateral relations and means of boosting them in all domains. The meeting was attended by advisor and at the Emir Diwan Mahmoud Taif al-Sharar. His Honor the Emir Sheikh Sabah Ahmed Al-Jaber al-Sabah sent a cable of congratulations to His Excellency the President of the Palestinian State and Head of the Executive Committee of the Palestinian Liberation Organization Mahmoud Abbas on the occasion of his recent successful medical tests. In the cable, His Honor the Emir wished President Abbas good health and wellness. His Honor the Crown Prince Sheikh Nawaf Ahmed Al-Jaber al-Sabah sent a cable of congratulations to His Excellency the President of the Palestinian State and Head of the Executive Committee of the Palestinian Liberation Organization Mahmoud Abbas on the occasion of his recent successful medical tests. His Honor Sheikh Jaber al-Mubarak al-Hamed al-Sabah, the Prime Minister, also sent a similar cable of congratulations. His Honor the Crown Prince Sheikh Nawaf Ahmed al-Jaber al-Sabah underwent medical checkups in the United States that came out very positive. His Honor the Crown Prince will take a private vacation in the United States before moving to Europe, where he will spend a few more days. The National Assembly Bureau today held a meeting under the chairmanship of Speaker Marzouk Ali Ghanem and in the presence of the Bureau members. Following the meeting, the Parliament Secretary, MP Dr. Ouda Al-Rouai, said in a press statement that the Bureau discussed a number of financial and administrative topics related to the General Secretariat, noting that some of them were postponed to examine whether they are consistent with the regulations. Al-Rouai added that the Bureau also tackled various topics related to Parliament sessions and ways of enhancing the efficiency of technology means used in different sectors of the Parliament. The National Assembly Speaker Marzouk Ali Ghanem said he invited the MPs to hold a meeting next Tuesday at the National Assembly Bureau to discuss the latest regional developments and the issue of convicted fugitive, whether those sentenced in national security or public funds. Speaker Ghanem said in a press conference held today at the Parliament that he coordinated with the government to attend the meeting, noting that any MP who has a question or an observation can present it at the session. The first Deputy Premier and Foreign Minister, Sheikh Sabah Al-Khalid Al-Hamid Al-Sabah, met today at Bayan Palace with the visiting Special Envoy of His Excellency, the President of the Republic of Kenya and Secretary General of the Jubilee Party, Raphael Tuju. The Minister of Education and Minister of Higher Education, Dr. Mohamed Al-Faris, attended the final ceremony of Sheikh Afadi Al-Sa'ad Al-Sabah Science Contest. The contest was first launched in 1999, aiming at consolidating the image of women through investing in Kuwaiti women so as to achieve sustainable development. The foreign ministers of Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, Bahrain, and Egypt lauded the role of His Highness Emir Sheikh Sabah Ahmed Al-Jaber Al-Sabah in resolving the Gulf tension within an Arab framework. They said in a statement issued at the conclusion of their meeting in Manama that they are ready for dialogue with Qatar if the latter complied with the previously announced demands. The Bahraini foreign minister said in a joint press conference with his Saudi, UAE, and Egyptian counterparts that the Manama meeting is part of their recent Cairo consultations. Lebanese sources said today that Hezbollah and the Nusra Front will exchange the corpses of fire in the first stage of a ceasefire agreement in the Lebanon-Syria border area. The ceasefire took effect on Thursday, July 27th, and will also involve the release of five Hezbollah prisoners and the departure of Nusra fighters to northern Syria, along with any civilians who wish to go with them. In other news, Egyptian security sources said today that a man who stabbed three foreign tourists to death and wounded three more earlier this month at a Red Sea resort had tried to join the IS group. Officials say Abdulrahman Shaban killed two German women and a Czech woman and wounded three other tourists at the popular Red Sea resort of Hurghada on July 14th. The sources said that the investigators have recommended that Shaban face terrorism charges. Israeli court today upheld jail term of ex-soldier who shot dead a Palestinian when he was laying wounded on the ground. Sergeant Elar Azari, a conscript infantry medic, was captured on video firing once into the head of the Palestinian after the man had been shot by other soldiers on March 24, 2016. In January 2017, he was found guilty of manslaughter, and in February, he was sentenced to 18 months in prison, far less than prosecutors requested. Somali police said that a car bomb explosion in the capital Mogadishu killed today six and wounded 20 others, and the death toll was likely to rise. Police said that the bomb went off on a busy road and was followed by big clouds of smoke. They said that the victims were civilians, pedestrians shopping or passing by. It was not clear who was responsible for the blast. The Australian Federal Police, AFP, said today that the security has been tightened at Australian airports after police foiled plans for a bomb attack on an aircraft during counter-terrorism raids in which four men were arrested. The increased security presence caused minor delays for some air transport operators, and authorities warned travelers to prepare for potentially more significant disruptions as traffic picked up during the week. AFP Commissioner Andrew Colvin said police did not have a great deal of information on the specific attack, the location, date or time, but the investigation indicated that the aviation industry was potentially a target. In other news, the United States said it flew two supersonic B-1B bombers over the Korean Peninsula in a show of force today after Pyongyang's recent tests of intercontinental ballistic missiles. The U.S. statement said that the B-1B flight was in direct response to the missile test and the previous July 3rd launch of the Hwangsong 14 rocket. It said the bombers took off from U.S. airbase in Guam and were joined by Japanese and South Korean fighter jets during the exercise. Now, the developments, Venezuelans began voting today for a constitutional superbody expected to hand sweeping powers to ruling Socialist Party officials and potentially extend their rule. President Nicolas Maduro has promised the assembly will restore peace after a month of opposition protests during which more than 115 people have been killed. Opposition parties are boycotting what they are call a rigged election, while their sympathizers plan demonstrations across the country during the day. Now, moving on to business news, South Korea President Moon Jae-in today appointed a former top envoy who had negotiated a free trade agreement with the United States as his new minister for trade at a time when Washington is seeking to amend the deal. Kim Hyung-jong, a U.S.-trained lawyer, was instrumental in framing South Korea's negotiating position on the deal for the president, Roh Moo-hyun, who surprised the country by choosing to initiate talk for the trade agreement. U.S. President Donald Trump has called the free trade agreement a horrible deal, saying he might even scrap it. And in sports, American Lily King broke the world record for women's 50-meter breaststroke with a time of 29.40 seconds at the World Swimming Championship today. In Formula One, Sebastian Vettel won a 10th Hungarian Grand Prix today in a Ferrari 1-2 that stretched his championship lead to 14 points. As for the weather forecast here in Kuwait, tonight it's going to be relatively hot with light to moderate northwesterly wind with speed of 15 to 45 kilometers per hour. As for tomorrow, it's going to be very hot with moderate to fresh northwesterly wind with speed of 20 to 50 kilometers per hour, causing rising dust, especially over open areas. The minimum temperature expected for tomorrow is 36 degrees Celsius, and the maximum temperature expected to be for tomorrow is 50 degrees Celsius. That's all the news for now. Thank you for listening and have a good night.
you up.
Talk to
spin forward. And time never stops. History is a record of our experiences.
If we had taken common measures for our safety, this renewal of the curse need never have fallen upon us.
And it always rhymes.
I have a dream.
Join us as we take a trip back in time.
Let us go forth to lead the land we love.
To reveal the events.
This salt comes from the Indian Ocean. Did every Indian claim it as his right?
Visit the places.
As citizens of Berlin, and therefore, as a free man.
And meet the people who made the world what it is today.
He knew that if you didn't turn out an aggressor, then you could have simply terrible consequences for future generations.
As we discover how we can plan and build a better future.
For the sake of our principles, for the sake of the Kuwaiti people, we stood our ground because the world would not look the other way. Ambassador El Saba, tonight, Kuwait is free.
This Day in History is edited by Sabah Ribat and Hussa Khalid. Presented by Nirmin Hazem. Executed by Abdullah Al-Ajmi. This Day in History is directed by Salman Al-Zaidi.
Today is July the 30th.
Local historical events.
In the year 1963, the first Council of Education was created. In the year 1936, some 80 Kuwaiti merchants welcomed a decree obliging them to allocate 0.5% of customs duties for their education budget. In the year 1944, the Kuwaiti Emir Sheikh Ahmed Al-Jaber Al-Sabah issued the first health law. In the year 1984, the artist Ruda Al-Mahanna died at 85. She was a famous pop singer in Kuwait and the Gulf region. She began her career when she was only 15 years old. In the year 2003, Kuwait National Cinema Company opened new three cinemas at Marina Mall at Salmiya suburb.
International historical events.
In the year 1619, in Jamestown, Virginia, the first elected legislative assembly, the New World, the House of Burgesses, convenes in the choir of the town's church. Earlier that year, the London Company, which had established the Jamestown settlement 12 years before, directed Virginia Governor Sir George Yeardley to summon a general assembly elected by the settlers, with every free adult male voting. 22 representatives from the 11 Jamestown bureaus were chosen, and Master John Pori was appointed Assembly Speaker. In the year 1956, 2 years after pushing to have the phrase "under God" inserted into the Pledge of Allegiance, President Dwight D. Eisenhower signs a law officially declaring "In God We Trust" to be the nation's official motto. The law PL84-140 also mandated that the phrase be printed on all American paper currency. In the year 1966, in the first televised World Cup soccer match, host nation England beats Germany 4-2 to win the tournament final at Wembley Stadium. In overtime play, England's Geoff Hurst scored his second of three match goals to give Britain a 3-2 lead. In the year 1971, a mid-air collision between a Boeing 727 and a fighter jet in Japan kills 162 people on this date. The military plane was flying without a radar, while Nippon Airways Flight 58 was traveling from Chito's airport in Hokkaido to Tokyo, falling largely with numbers of a group dedicated to the assistance of war victims. Takeoff was uneventful and the plane soon reached 28,000 feet, cruising over the Japanese Alps. Flight 58 suddenly encountered two military jets. One of the Japanese F-86 Sabre jets was piloted by Captain Kuma. The other was being flown by his student, Sergeant Ichikawa, who had only a few hours of flying experience. Neither jet was equipped with a radar, which would have indicated the presence of the Boeing 727. In the year 1976, American Bruce Jenner wins gold in the decathlon at the Montreal Olympics. His 8,617 points set a world record in the event. The secret to Jenner's success was his preparation. In the 1970s, most decathletes trained with other decathletes. Bruce Jenner, however, trained with some of the world's best athletes in each of the 10 decathlon events. After his win, Jenner enjoyed the unofficial title of World's Greatest Athlete and appeared in movies on television and, of course, adored at Wheaties Box. He was voted the 1976 AP Male Athlete of the Year. The 1976 Olympics was his last decathlon. In the year 2003, the last of 21,529,464 Volkswagen Beetles built since World War II was on the production line at Volkswagen's plant in Puebla, Mexico. One of a 3,000-unit final edition, the baby blue vehicle was sent to a museum in Wolfsburg, Germany, where Volkswagen is headquartered. The car produced in Puebla that day was the last so-called classic Volkswagen Beetle, which is not to be confused with a redesigned new Beetle that Volkswagen introduced in 1998. The new Beetle resembles the classic version but is based on the Volkswagen Golf. The roots of the classic Beetle stretch back to the mid-1930s when the famed Austrian automotive engineer Dr. Ferdinand Porsche met German leader Adolf Hitler's request for a small, affordable passenger car to satisfy the transportation needs of the German people. Hitler called the result the KDF, Kraftdurchfahrtwagen, or Strength Through Joy car, after the Nazi-led movement ostensibly aimed at helping the working people of Germany. It would later be known by the name Porsche preferred, Volkswagen, or People's Car. In 1977, however, the Beetle with its rear-mounted air-cooled engine was banned in America for failing to meet safety and emission standards. Worldwide sales of the car shrank by the late 1970s, and by the 1988, the classic Beetle was sold only in Mexico. Due to increased competition from other manufacturers of inexpensive combat cars and a Mexican decision to phase out two-door taxis, Volkswagen decided to discontinue production of the classic Bug in 2003. The final count of 21,529,464 incidentally did not include the original 600 cars built by the Nazis prior to World War II.
You were listening to This Day in History. Join us again tomorrow at the same time for another episode of This Day in History. This Day in History is edited by Sabah Raybuk and Hussa Khalid. Presented by Nirmin Hazim. Executed by Abdullah Al-Ajmi. This Day in History is directed by Salman Al-Zaidi.
soul and laugh. Sometimes you gotta take a chance to break through. And when the world is not enough, that's what gives you everything or breaks you. Feeling empty, feel used. It's like we're running on fumes. A little broken, confused. But one thing I know for sure, ain't giving up on you. Ain't giving up on you. We'll be right back.
She was staring at the windswept sea. Two pearl handle pistols and a banjo on her knee. Dig a hole in the meadow. Dig a hole in the cold, cold ground. Dig a hole in the hole in the meadow. Lay my lily down. Dig a hole in the hole in the meadow. Dig a hole in the cold, cold ground. Dig a hole in the hole in the meadow. Oh, lay my lily down. Lay my lily down. Lay my lily down. Lay my lily down. Oh, lay my lily down.
This is an awareness message to avoid and prevent any of the mentioned security and traffic violations which regularly occur and would cause traffic accidents leading to injury or death. Reckless driving. Driving is an art. Please do not drive recklessly. Use of the seatbelt and other safety measures will prevent serious accidents. This message was brought to you with compliments of the Public Relations and Moral Guidance Department and Media Security Department from the Ministry of Interior.
This is the International English Broadcasting Radio of the State of Kuwait presenting Islam in a Woman's Heart. So many women all over the world with different backgrounds and different beliefs, but no matter how different they are, they all have a heart full of passion. And when one opens her heart to Islam, she discovers a new meaning for life, a new feeling, the purest love of all, the love of God, Allah Almighty.
Oh, the white moon rose over us from the valley of Wada, and we owe it to show gratefulness where the call is to Allah, where the call is to Allah.
Islam in a Woman's Heart is a program that will be presenting the stories of those women who have opened their hearts to Islam and how that decision changed their lives. Islam in a Woman's Heart, prepared and presented by Shijun Abdullah, directed by Abdulaziz Al-Hajji.
Who raised amongst us, coming with a word to be obeyed. You have brought to the certain nobleness. Welcome, best caller to God's way. Welcome, best caller to God's way.
Our beloved listeners, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We welcome you again to our show, Islam in a Woman's Heart. Thank you.
previous episode, we were narrating the story of a young lady called Hoda Dog, who from a very young age decided to become a member of the church down the road. She enjoyed the activities they did, made her own faith group, where they decided to discuss religion and religious issues, and raised questions they never found answers to, not by themselves, nor by the church. Later, when she joined college, Hoda was interested in church activities and in learning about different cultures. She joined in a conversation class where they mix Native American speakers with non-English speakers from many different countries in order for them to learn how to speak and express themselves in English. One of those people she met was a Muslim Palestinian man named Fares. The more she spoke with him, the more she was interested in Islam. Later, she took a class about Islam and contacted the mosque to meet up with an American Muslim lady. In Islam, Hoda found all the answers to the questions she had that the church couldn't answer. Later on, she said her shahada and told her parents. They didn't mind it at all, but they were concerned about her decision to wear the hijab. They didn't want her to be discriminated against. She then got back in touch with Fares. And after a year of her conversion, they decided to get married. And that again caused another problem with her family. Hoda says, I had gotten back in touch with Fares, the Muslim Palestinian man from the conversation group, the one who first promoted me to get interested in Islam. He was still in Portland area, attending the community college. We started meeting again over lunch in the library. We were married the following summer, after my sophomore year, a year after my shahada. And that's when my family freaked out. They weren't quite yet over my hijab, and they felt like I had thrown something else at them. They argued that I was too young and worried that I would abandon my goals, drop out of school, become a young mother, and destroy my life. They liked my husband, but they didn't trust him at first. They were thinking that he wanted to marry me to get the green card. My family and I fought over this for several months, and I feared that our relationship together would never be repaired. That was 3 years ago, and a lot has changed. Fares and I moved to Corvallis in Oregon, home of Oregon State University. We lived in a very strong and close-knit Muslim community. I graduated magna cum laude last year with a degree in child development. I have had several jobs, from secretary to preschool teacher, with no problems about my hijab. I'm active in the community and still do volunteer work. My husband will finish his electrical engineering degree this year, inshallah. I visit my family a couple of times a year, And I met Farah's parents, too, for the first time this summer. They see that Islam has brought me happiness. Not pain and sorrow. It brought me peace. They are proud of my accomplishments and can see that I am truly happy. Our relationship is back to normal, and thank God for that. And they are looking forward to our visit next month, inshallah. Looking back on all of this, I feel truly grateful that Allah has guided me to where I am today. I truly feel blessed. It seems that all of this piece of my life fit together in a pattern. I was like a puzzle with plenty of missing pieces, and now I am complete. And thank God for that.
Isn't it so funny how we all walk around, never even thinking of the days under the ground? The drive and ambition taking over our lives, for this world, for the fame, for the power do we strive. Our minds made up, whatever it takes to feed the desires that this heart makes. Why don't we know? How do we stay within the boundaries of the right way? When we step out of our homes in the middle of the day, do we ever think when's the end of our day? Someone dies in the news right in front of your face. Do we ever think when's my turn in the grave? To read all the tales of the kings of the past, do we ever think how long did it last? Day after day, night after night, do we ever think when's the end of my life? So many excuses, so many reasons to stay away from the truth, to know what we can, trying hard to run away from the truth of this life, from the test, from the hardship as sharp as a knife. Why don't we know, understand that it's true, on that day in the end, we'll be held accountable. So let's make up our minds to do the right thing in this life, in our chance, Allah's name do we sing. Allah, 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 Ya Allah. Ooh. When we step out of our homes in the middle of the day, do we ever think when's the end of our stay? Someone dies in the news, of your face. Do we ever think when's my turn in the grave? To read all the tales of the kings of the past, do we ever think how long did it last? Day after day, night after night, do we ever think when's the end of my life? When we step out of our homes in the middle of the day, do we the end of my stay? Someone dies in the news right in front of your face. Do we ever think when's my turn in the grave? To read all the tales of the kings of the past, do we ever think how long did it last? Day after day, oh, night after night, do we ever think?
Although it was hard at the beginning to decide to become a Muslim, to decide to wear the hijab, to go through the first Ramadan all by myself, walk all the way to college, to get my meals for Fatur and Suhoor. And the meals were both the same for the whole month of Ramadan. It was very hard to convince my family. It was very hard to find friends that shared my same interest, to understand me, to understand my new faith, and who I'd become. It was a hard process to go through all of it. But thank God, it was worth it. And God led me to the right path. He made it easy on me. He took my hand and showed me the way. He opened a light in my heart. And I feel now that I am with my beloved husband and I'm in a community full of Muslims, like sisters and brothers all together, a strong community. I feel like my life has changed. It has become a lot better. The peace I used to live in, the quiet time I used to sit and listen to the nature. I still do that with my new faith. Yet before, it felt like it came from deep down inside me, and no one else from church were able to connect, especially when I went to that church where there was a rock band. No peace there at all. Yet in Islam, it is the religion of peace. And it is where I found myself. I thank God day and night for leading me to the right path. As God says, Allah's guidance is the only guidance. And we have been directed to submit ourselves to the Lord of the worlds. Beloved listeners, that was the story of Huda Dodd and how she opened her heart to Islam. Join us next time for more stories of women who opened their heart to Islam. Thank you for listening. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Listening to Islam in a Woman's Heart, prepared and presented by Shajun Abdullah, directed by Abdulaziz Al-Hajji.
Show gratefulness where the call is to Allah, where the call is to Allah. Ayyuhal Mahdubi.
Radio Kuwait, transmitting on 963 kHz on the medium wave for our listeners in the state of Kuwait and the Arabian Gulf area. Our local listeners can also receive our transmission on 93.3 MHz on the FM band. As for our listeners in Europe and North America, we are transmitting on 15,540 kHz on the 25-meter band on the shortwave. Dear listeners, if you have any reception reports you'd like to send us, please send them to kwtfreq@hotmail.com. That's kwtfreq@hotmail.com. You can also send them to this mailing address, Ministry of Information, Engineering Affairs, Department of Frequencies, P.O. Box 967, Safat, Code 13010, Kuwait. You can also fax your reception reports to this number, 00965-2241-5498. One more time, 00965-2241-5498.
Got a girl from the south side, got brazen hair. First time I seen her walk by, how about I fell off my chair? Had to get her number, something like 6 weeks. Now me and her go way back, like Cadillac 6. Body like a black girl, shining with my eyes closed. I know every curve like the back of my hand. 15 and 30, I ain't in no hurry. I'ma take your soul just as fast as I can. Why she missing? She don't need no bed, but I can turn them inside out. I don't need no help. Got hips like her head, so thick and so sweet. Ain't no curves like her, them downtown streets. Body like a bad girl, driving with my eyes closed. I know every curve like the back of my hand. 15 and 30, I ain't in no hurry. I'ma take the sun just as fast as I can. Tangled up in the tall grass, my lips on hers. On the highway to heaven, at the south of a smile. Get there when we get there, every inch is a mile. Body like a bad girl, diving with my eyes closed. I know every curve like the back of my hand. 15 and 30.
Program of Radio Kuwait present a guide to healthy nutritions. A guide to healthy nutritions is a special show that explores all aspects of healthy nutritions. The show is written by Shijun al-Mershud presented by Naha Hassan and directed by Amina Hamid Shah.
Radio Kuwait's continuing program about how eating nutritious food can help us maintain a healthier body and mind. Since the dawn of time, human beings have been aware of medicinal benefits that can be derived from using natural food products, such as plants, flowers, and spices, as well as herbs. These food products can help maintain both our physical and mental health by enhancing the body's immune system, thus protecting us against a wide variety of diseases and harmful conditions. And in today's episode, we will discover a new type of plant called mustard. The mustard plant is one of several plant species in the Brassicaceae family of vegetables, which also include cabbage and broccoli. For thousands of years, it was originally cultivated by indigenous people living in temperate regions of Europe. From these early beginnings, it was then grown in North Africa, Asia, and throughout other regions of the European continent, and was very popular amongst the ancient Greeks and Romans. Today, mustard is now cultivated in more than 21 countries across the globe, including Nepal, Canada, Ukraine, and India. And due to its distinctive taste and unique medicinal properties, it is widely used in both traditional cooking and herbal medicine by millions of people around the world. The mustard plant has several different species, which include white mustard, which is believed to have originated around the eastern Mediterranean region. It is commonly referred to as yellow mustard and has a delicious taste. It is widely used in the preparation of American spices, such as the world-famous condiment yellow mustard, and its seeds are larger than the black variety. Black mustard is popular for its aroma and strong flavor, and is found in abundance throughout the Middle East. Brown mustard, which is believed to have originated in the Himalayas, is like the black variety. It has flowers that are pale yellow in color, and it has seeds which are light brown and have a sharp, distinct taste. Mustard has a whole range of healthy ingredients contained within its various edible parts. Its seeds and green leaves are a rich source of useful minerals such as calcium, magnesium, phosphorus, and potassium. They also have a high proportion of both folic acid and vitamins A, K, and C. These valuable nutrients help keep our bodies healthy and provide energy that enable vital processes to occur within the body. Knowledge of the nutritional content and healing properties in mustard is well documented, and evidence of this can be found in ancient Indian Sanskrit writings dating back approximately 5,000 years. In ancient Greece and Rome, mustard seeds were used for cooking, and the Romans are known to have invented a kind of paste made from the seeds, which is thought by many to be the origin of the word mustard. Early physicians from various civilizations used pills made from mustard seeds to help treat a multitude of ailments and conditions, and there is evidence that Hippocrates, the founder of medicine, used mustard seeds to help treat the sick. The pharaohs of ancient Egypt also used mustard seeds, where they were used to treat a wide variety of conditions, including angina and muscle and joint pain. Today, mustard is one of the most popular spices in the world and is grown in vast quantities in countries such as Hungary, Britain, India, Canada, and the United States. In India, most households use seeds or mustard oil for a variety of cooking and medicinal purposes. It may be also used to create a mustard sauce, which is great for seasoning different types of food and traditional dishes, while mustard powder may be used to add flavor to food and to decorate traditional dishes. The three main varieties of mustard, white, brown, and black, are widely used in the spice industry. And as previously mentioned, all the plant's constituent parts, such as its leaves, seeds, and oil, can play an important role in food preparation, herbal medicine, and cosmetics. Important benefits of mustard oil is that it can help improve both digestive and circulatory function. It helps digestion by stimulating the secretion of digestive juices from the spleen and liver, thus increasing the absorption of energy-giving nutrients within the body. And improved secretion of digestive juices also serves to help soften the intestinal tract, improving its performance, increasing activity, and preventing constipation. Some people recommend that mustard oil may be massaged gently onto the abdomen to help improve blood circulation. Many also regard mustard as being highly efficient at absorbing toxins from within the stomach and intestines, and regular intake of a small amount of mustard oil is believed to help cleanse the stomach, colon, and intestines, preparing them for any further gastrointestinal treatment or therapy. Mustard oil may be used as an antibacterial agent to help fight infection in both the digestive and urinary tracts. The topical application of mustard oil to the abdominal area can also help expel trapped gases and regulate digestion. Mustard oil is rich in monounsaturated fats, as well as omega-3 and 6 fatty acids. These valuable acids help balance cholesterol levels by increasing good or benign cholesterol, while effectively lowering bad cholesterol in the body, thus reducing the risk of cardiovascular disease. This means that mustard oil can be an appropriate alternative to saturated oils like butter and cheese. Mustard is a good source of magnesium, which can help minimize some of the symptoms of Alzheimer's disease. It also helps reduce high blood pressure and limit the frequency of migraine attacks and strokes in people who suffer with atherosclerosis. May also offer relief for menopausal women who suffer with abnormal sleep patterns, such as insomnia. As with most green plants, mustard leaves have many nutritional benefits that can help maintain human health. And this has been confirmed by various scientific studies that show that the regular consumption of foods like mustard leaves can help reduce incidences of cardiovascular disease. This positive effect of helping to reduce the risk factors for many cardiovascular diseases, such as atherosclerosis, means that mustard may also be useful in regulating cholesterol levels within the blood, and which in turn supports the health of the body's cells lining the walls of both the stomach and intestines. Mustard oil is a natural remedy for asthma and sinusitis. And in cases of an asthma attack, massage the chest with mustard oil to help improve airflow to the lungs. You can also mix a teaspoon of sugar with a tablespoon of mustard oil and eat several times to help alleviate asthma. Alternatively, one can take a mixture of honey and mustard oil 3 times per day to also help treat asthma. Mustard oil is considered one of the best oils for helping to cleanse or purify the mouth of harmful germs and microbes. And a mixture made from mustard and clove oils can help protect the teeth from dental decay, as well as helping to alleviate bad breath and gingivitis. And the mixture can either be applied individually to the affected areas or combined with a regular toothpaste for best results. But one should, of course, always consult a doctor before considering using any kind of herbal medicine. Mustard oil is also useful for those
who are prone to colds and coughs, as it helps to clear congestion of the chest and nose. All you need to do is apply a mixture consisting of a teaspoon of mustard oil and camphor oil to the chest, and then lie down to allow the therapeutic vapors to enter and soothe the lungs. You can also add a few tablespoons
overcome by the nostalgias. I am on call when you need me, let me know. But we're drifting in a strange way. I'm aware that it's a mistake if I love you, it's a mistake if I don't. You know, space and time wouldn't let you be mine, but I've come to understand it's entropy. Pretending it's all, holding her closely, remembering your touch, and I'm not by your finger, even though I'm not love, in the arms of a stranger, pretending it's all. And the nostalgia's killing me. And it's all because, oh, oh, I'm in the arms of a stranger, pretending it's love, holding her closely, remembering your touch, and I'm not by your finger, even though I'm not love. In the arms of a stranger, pretending it's love.
Oh, true love, oh, true love, oh, true love.
inside my head. Waves from the sea of guilty mess. Why is our sorrow in the blue? But now I've found you.
an awareness message to avoid and prevent any of the mentioned security and traffic violations which regularly occur and would cause traffic accidents leading to injury or death. Seat belts. It is necessary to protect you and the passenger in case of accidents, to prevent smashing your head against the glass or flying out of the car, especially the children. This message was brought to you with compliments of the Public Relations and Moral Guidance Department and Media Security Department from the Ministry of Interior.
I wanna follow where she goes. I think about it and she knows it. I wanna let it take control. Cause every time that she gets closer, she pulls me in enough to keep me guessing. Maybe I should stop and start confessing. Confessing, yeah. Oh, I've been shaking. I love it when you go crazy. You take all my inhibitions. Baby, there's nothing holding me back. You take me places that tear out my reputation. Manipulate my decisions. Baby, there's nothing holding me back. Says that she's never afraid. Just picture everybody. She really doesn't like to wait. Not really into hesitation. Pulls me in enough to keep me guessing. Oh, maybe I should stop and start confessing. Confessing, yeah. Oh, I've been shaking. I love it when you go crazy. You take all my inhibitions. Baby, there's nothing holding me back. You take me places that tear up my reputation. Manipulate my decisions. Baby, there's nothing holding me back. We took it way too far. I know we'd be alright. I know we would be alright if you were by my side. When we stumbled in the dark, I know we'd be alright. I know we would be alright. Cause if we lost our minds and we took it way too far, I know we'd be alright. I know we would be alright if you were by my side. And we stumbled in the dark, I know we'd be alright. We would be alright. Shaking, I love it when you go crazy. You take all my inhibitions. Baby, there's nothing holding me back. You take me places that tear up my reputation. Manipulate my decisions. Baby, there's nothing holding me back.
And the price on the soul is saved. I'm meant to know the answers. They belong to by by.
You can be mad at me, tell me I was born to quit, I was checking, oh. Or you could just freak with me, set it again, let the numbers roll. Hear that about you, baby, back when the city's cold. Don't ever look at me like that, it's just in the name I know. It's just in the name I know.
Oh, my broken screen, I'm a map routine, it's about to know that I'm over. Thank you.
welcome to the final show. Hope you're wearing your best coat. You can't block the door on your way to the sky. You look pretty good down here, but you ain't really good. We never thought of looking here before. Why are we always stuck in running home? The bullet. The bullet. We never thought of looking here before. Why are we always stuck in running home? The bullet. The bullet.
This is Radio Kuwait, the time now is 11:50 p.m. Kuwait local time. Hello, welcome to the late night news update. I'm Hamid Ibrahim. His Hands the Crown Prince, Sheikh Nawaf Ahmed Al Jaber Al Sabah, underwent medical checkups in the United States that came out very positive. His Hands the Crown Prince will take a private vacation in the United States before leaving for Europe, where he will spend a few more days. In other news, the first step in a ceasefire between Hezbollah and the Nusra Front took place today as the two sides exchanged the bodies of fighters killed in clashes between them. Five Hezbollah prisoners held by Nusra will also be released as part of the agreement. The local ceasefire came into effect last Thursday and involved the departure of al-Nusra militants from the area around Arsal. Nusra and IS have been present in the mountains near Arsal in northern Lebanon for years. The most serious spillover, Syria civil war into its neighbors. Israeli court today upheld jail term of ex-soldier who shot dead a Palestinian when he was lying wounded on the ground. Sergeant Elor Azari, a conscript infantry medic, was captured on video firing once into the head of the Palestinian after the man had been shot by other soldiers on March 24 of 2016. In January 2017, he was found guilty of manslaughter, and in February, he was sentenced to 18-month imprisonment, far less than prosecutors requested. And in the United States said today that it shot down a medium-range target ballistic missile in its latest test of the country's THAAD missile defense program, which is designed to protect the country against potential threats from countries such as North Korea and Iran. And for a final story, protesters blocked roads and clashed with security forces today as Venezuelans trickled to the polls to elect a constitutional super body that leftist President Nicolas Maduro vowed would begin a new era in the crisis-stricken nation. Maduro has pressed ahead with the vote to create the all-powerful assembly despite the threat of further U.S. sanctions, a month of opposition protests in which more than 115 people have been killed. As for business use, the FTSE 100 closed down 1% at 7,368.37. The main faller was British American Tobacco, down to 6.8% after U.S. proposals to cut cigarette nicotine. The second biggest faller was fellow cigarette producer Imperial Brands, down 3.79%. In other business news, British Airways owner IAG had a turbulent day and closed 0.08% lower. Barclays shares also went into reverse as investors digested into its half-year results, dropping 1.68%. Cost related to the sale of parts of its African business pushed it into a loss, but once these were stripped out, pre-tax profits were up by 13%. In sports news, Manchester United are close to signing Serbian midfielder Nemanja Matic from Chelsea for £40 million. Matic will be United's third summer buy following defender Victor Lindelof from Benfica and striker Romelu Lukaku from Everton. It will be the second time United manager Jose Mourinho has bought Matic, have signed him for Chelsea. As for the weather forecast here in Kuwait, tonight it is relatively hot with light to moderate northwesterly wind with speeds of 15 to 45 kilometers per hour. As for tomorrow, Monday will be very hot with moderate to fresh northwesterly winds with speed of 20 to 50 kilometers per hour, causing rising dust, particularly over open areas. The minimum temperature expected for tomorrow is 36 degrees Celsius, and the maximum temperature expected for tomorrow is 50 degrees Celsius. That's all the news for now. Thank you for listening. Have a good night.
Yo, I just started my sentence like a capital letter. Got bars for years, I hope you send me a letter. No, she'll never be queen, so now she got the vendetta. I ain't talking about David when I say I'm a getter.
I feel like we're going under. Take me down, I can't help but wonder. You got everything I wanted. If you keep on talking, I'ma put it where you wanna. Keep up, ain't no need to slow it down. We could get it poppin', you could let me love me downtown. You got everything I want now. Let me fill your fantasies and give you what you dream about. You got something that I believe I've been waiting for all my. We're blazing high, snow filled the night. I'm gasoline, you're fire. What you wanna bet that you never find another like me? No one's in a lifetime. Only get all of me once in your lifetime. Oh, me, you're chilling in your wet dreams. Swimming in my love, stuff it up in your wet dream. Baby, let me blow your cover. This won't make me wish I was your part-time lover. You got something that I believe I've been waiting for.
This is Radio Kuwait. It is now almost midnight in the state of Kuwait. That's 2100 GMT. And it's now time to close down our English language transmission. We shall be resuming our transmission tomorrow morning at 8 a.m. Kuwait local time. That's 0500 GMT on 963 kilohertz on the medium wave for our listeners in the state of Kuwait and the Arabian Gulf area. At the same time, we shall also be resuming our transmission on 93.3 megahertz band for our local listeners. As for our listeners in Europe and North America, we shall meet tomorrow evening at 9 p.m. local time. That's 1800 hours GMT on 15,540 kilohertz on the 25-meter band on shortwave.